I think of sepsis, I think of a very sick child who's got an infection, and it might be bacterial or it might be viral. What we want as paediatricians is a test that is quick, that's cheap, and is accurate. And that's not an easy thing to come by.
It's like a new era of personalised medicine.
Testing for pathogens is part of the solution, but it's not the whole solution. We need better tests.
Hello and welcome to our Paediatric Sepsis podcast, brought to you by the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health, Health Education England and Medisense.
My name is Emma Lim and I'm a general consultant at the Great North Children's Hospital. And also hello from Monica. Monica Parker is our voice of reason and a junior doctor and teaching fellow, also from the Great North Children's Hospital, Newcastle upon Tyne.
Today, it's my great pleasure to be introducing a guest from The Big Smoke. So I have Jethro Herberg here. Jethro is a senior clinical researcher in Imperial College, and I've known you for many years, mostly in the pub, I have to say. Why I wanted to talk to you today, Jethro, is because I want to horizon scan. I want to think about what's next for sepsis.
Hello, Emma. Thanks very much for asking me to contribute to your podcast. My name is Jethro Herberg, and I'm a clinical senior lecturer, and I work at Imperial College London. I'm originally a scientist who did a science degree and a PhD, and then later in life I thought, actually, I really want to do something that connects me with people, and I switched to medicine. And now I find myself doing full circle, doing scientific research within the clinical discipline of paediatrics, and particularly with paediatric infectious diseases.
So this is a question that we're asking everybody that is a guest on the podcast, and it's a bit vague, but what does the word sepsis mean to you?
I tell you what, when you say what does sepsis mean, I actually think, well, it's a bit vague. So I think that not only is the question is vague, I think the answer is vague, because sepsis means different things to different people. And so my response is, when I hear the word sepsis, I think, do you mean bacterial infection? Do you mean a body's response to an infection that might be bacterial or non-bacterial? So actually, when I think of sepsis, I think of a very sick child who's got an infection, and it might be bacterial or it might be viral, but we're defining it on clinical grounds without necessarily needing to know what the infection is.
I want to think about what's next for sepsis. And for me, early recognition is everything. We know that clinical prediction tools are good, but they're not enough. They're not really sensitive or specific. And so the question for me is, do tests help? It's like we're looking for this holy grail. We need a test that can tell us whether it's a self-limiting viral infection or a serious bacterial infection. And we want something that tells us how sick you are, and something that's quick, like less than 30 minutes. So tell me about what exists right now and why it's not good enough.
Well, Emma, I totally agree with you that what we want as paediatricians is a test that is quick, that's cheap, and is accurate. And that's not an easy thing to come by. And the reason we need that is that even as experienced paediatricians, in the hurly-burly of all the different ways that children can present to us, it's possible to mix to mistake signs of sepsis or something else. It's also, we often think children are sicker than they are, and we end up over-treating children. And this is because there aren't any really reliable signs that we can take away as clinicians from examining our patients that tell us simply and accurately who's sick and who isn't sick. So what we have is a fudge, which is trying to make the best of the situation, where we look for the signs that are the most reliable, but they're not that great. You have to make a sacrifice between something that is very sensitive, which means you don't miss something, but it means you overcall in a lot of children, or you have something that's very specific, but it isn't sensitive enough to pick up all the children. And I would like to try and persuade you that actually, despite all the years of study and learning that the medical profession has made in the thousands of years since Hippocrates, that actually in the end, we're going to need to turn to a new paradigm of diagnosis that may be actually may put us as clinicians into a slightly different role to the one we're used to. Because I would say that we've got a problem with clinical assessment, like I've just said. We've also got a problem with diagnostic testing, because a lot of the things that make us sick, or very sick, frighteningly sick, can also be pathogens that you often find causing no harm in a patient. Let's take the example of an infection that causes devastating severe illness. It can lead to death, it can lead to amputations, it can lead to really awful outcomes for the patients who have this. And that's meningococcal sepsis. So we're very interested in this bug, because meningococcus is surprisingly a bug that every child will have harmlessly sitting in their throat at some point in their childhood. Yes, it's also the same bug that can cause severe illness. So if we design tests that look for infections by looking for the pathogen, we may find ourselves in a position where we found a pathogen, but we don't know whether it's actually causing the illness in the child in front of us. And so I think that there's a revolution in diagnostics based on quick, accurate detection of pathogens. But I worry it's only going to take us so far, because in the end, to be confident that the child in front of you who's ill is ill because of the bug you found, you need to know two things. You need to know what pathogen you found, but you also need to know how the body's immune system is responding. You might have something like Staphylococcus aureus, really common bug, lives on the skin. But on the other hand, it can also cause a devastating illness. So if you find Staph aureus in a patient, are you sure it's responsible for their disease and wasn't just there? So I think testing for pathogens is part of the solution, but it's not the whole solution. And I think if you ask a doctor who does assessment of these children, they will often reach for tests such as a simple blood test for looking at the number of white cells in the blood, or a blood test that measures the amount of a protein that we called C-reactive protein, or CRP, which is a marker for how much the body is responding to infection.
Okay, Jethro, hang on a second. I absolutely agree with you. I think it's all about colonization versus whether this pathogen is actually causing disease. That's the $6 million question. And as you say, the tests we have at the moment can't help us. And we all turn to these common tests. So I think white cell count, CRP, procalcitonin. When I was a junior doctor, I spent my entire time in PICU in Guy's taking samples to look to see if procalcitonin was a good indicator for sepsis and infection. And we're no further forward now. I'm still doing the same thing. I'm not actually taking the samples. Somebody else is doing it, but we're no further forward.
I'm doing it for you.
Thank you, Monica.
So it can be a bit helpful. And it's a bit helpful because it's the best thing we've got. I think white cell counts are the poor relation of CRP, but CRP are the poor relation of the next generation of tests. So white cell count is even more variable and inaccurate than measuring a CRP. So let me just go back a bit. What we're talking about here, is there a test that can tell us if someone's ill, and if they're ill, whether they're ill because of a bacterial infection or a common viral infection? So I'm going to go back even a further stage. I'm going to start this again. Child comes to us in A&E with a fever. This is a really common presentation. Okay, this is a large part of the workload of all pediatricians. And doesn't matter how many children you see with a fever, part of you, whenever you're a pediatrician, however experienced you are, always is asking yourself the question, I think this child's got a fever, and I don't think they look that sick. So I think it's probably nothing, but could I be wrong? And there's always a part of you, however experienced you are, that remains uncertain, and quite rightly so, because there are no great tests. And every now and then, you get a child who you can get this call on wrong. So we try to use everything else at our disposal to be more confident about our decision-making. One thing we can do is blood tests. A white cell count looks at the number of white cells circulating in the blood. It tends to go up in an infection, and your neutrophils tend to go up more than your lymphocytes in a bacterial infection. but it's not very reliable. But if you get a really stonkingly high white cell count, or in fact a really low, abnormally low white cell count, it makes you sit up and take notice. So the best thing it does is act as a little bit of a nudge to help you in your thinking. CRP, I would say, is one better than that. It's a protein that's made by the liver that goes up when you're fighting an infection and tends to go up high into the hundreds if you've got a severe bacterial infection. But again, it's not completely reliable. If you get a really high result, then great, it helps you. But actually, often, those really high results are seen in the children who are the sickest, where you didn't actually need the test to tell you what to do anyway. And there's a real problem with these tests, is that the children we're most unsure about, who are slightly in the middle clinically, are the ones who most often have the middling tests as well. And what we need are better biomarkers. So what we are working on is to see whether we can start measuring many more biomarkers from the patient at the same time. And I'm part of a group we're all really excited about the possibility of, instead of measuring proteins like CRP or procalcitonin, which have been used for a long time, we're going to measure nucleic acids, RNA molecules, in fact.
If you're interested in a career in paediatrics, the best specialty in medicine, please see www.rcpch.ac.uk/careers.
Jethro, what you were saying is the big problem is the grey area is still grey. And yes. There's no good tests that can pull apart if they're really sick or not. And you're part of a new group that are looking at biomarkers as a new test. Can you explain to us what a biomarker is first?
Yes, biomarker is a very general term. It refers to the idea that you can measure something that tells you what ultimately is the biological or the clinical state of that patient. So we're talking about biomarkers that tell us when a child is fighting a bacterial infection. So we're looking for things that we can measure that are accurate predictors of when someone's fighting a bacterial infection.
And the biomarkers that you're looking at are more specific than that. So you're not just looking at ones that can tell you bacteria from virus, but you're looking at a whole range of pathogens.
Yeah, we think there's going to be a whole new paradigm of testing patients in the next decade or so. And it's going to be based on the fact that whilst we've got some biomarkers like CRP, which are moderately good at the moment, we could actually be measuring different things that will be much more accurate, much more helpful, much more discriminatory between a whole range of conditions. So if a child comes to any department with a fever, that's a really common presentation. Common things in common, you might think, well, the viral infection is the most likely thing. The other thing we have to think about, apart from viral infections, are things that are serious, even if they're not so common. So, for instance, a bacterial infection needing antibiotics. But this is just one small segment of a huge range of possible diagnoses. Even though they may be more common than the others, there's a whole lot of other really important diagnoses that we don't have good tests for and that we don't consider. There's a whole range of inflammatory diseases that children can get. But what about those children who've actually got an cancer? They can come in with a fever. Often our first-line tests are really geared towards looking between bacterial and viral infections. We're interested in perhaps a slightly Star Trek concept that you could take a small amount of blood, maybe even just a capillary sample of blood, a few hundred microliters, put it into a machine that will measure simultaneously a whole lot of different biomarkers and tell you that we predict that this child has got condition X or Y or Z or A or B or C, etc., and won't just tell us about one analyte measuring one on one axis.
So it's like a new era of personalised medicine, that you will present with maybe one or two or three things like just fever and a rash, and you could have a tiny test that potentially can tell you a whole number of different things. And in that, it can also maybe predict how quickly or how severe that illness can be.
Yes, that's true as well.
At the moment, we don't have good tests either that can predict the severity or how quickly children are going to become ill. We've started using lactate. There are some new tests looking at things like interleukin-6. But I think that's another area where we'd really like to be able to have more information so that actually if you came in and it was early but you were going to get sick, we'd know to keep you in hospital.
Yeah, so Emma, absolutely, I agree that a test that could tell you this child is someone who needs to be kept in hospital and looked after because they're, even if they're not sick now, they're about to get sick. That would be a brilliant test to have. And that's one of the questions we're trying to address by designing a new generation of biomarker tests for children that are based on gene expression in blood. So we are working on this concept that your body's white cells, which are circulating in the blood and are easily accessible to a doctor skilled with a needle. So we work on the idea that you can access this information from blood by measuring simultaneously the levels of different genes that are good discriminators of different conditions. So for instance, if you have a meningococcal infection, meningococcus is a bacterium covered with a cell wall, a gram-negative cell wall, that reliably and predictably switches on a whole lot of pathways leading to new gene expression in your white cells that are associated with these bacterial components. It'll also switch off some pathways. And we can measure these genes that are in these pathways and see which ones have gone up and which ones have gone down and say, aha, this pattern of response makes it look like this patient's got an infection with meningococcus. We can also do that for another bacteria and actually see a slightly different set of genes have been switched on or off, even though it's still a bacterial infection, just by identifying the fact it's a different type of bacteria with a different set of components. We can see an even bigger response if we look at a child with a viral infection, where we'll see, for instance, a whole lot of pathways downstream of the interferon signaling molecules that have been switched on. And so we are gradually building up a picture, but every single different febrile illness in children has its own unique pattern of gene expression, with some genes switched on and other genes switched off. And we are now in a really exciting phase of developing this work, because we think by measuring a modest number of genes, we can predict from one blood sample what's wrong with a child, mapping it to a whole range of different causes, and potentially also, as you said, mapping it to a whole range of different severities.
We've been talking a lot about markers of severity, and there was a lot in the news recently about a new test developed by the University of Strathclyde researchers using interleukin-6 as a protein biomarker for sepsis. What do you think about that, and do you think that will be enough to help us at the bedside? Is it specific enough? Is it just another procalcitonin on steroids?
So interleukin-6 has long been known as a key molecule in the response to serious bacterial infection. And there's a difference between knowing something theoretically and really showing its work. So it's showing it works. So I think it's great that teams like the one in Strathclyde can take this to clinical use and show its utility in a clinical situation. And that's good. That's very good. We know that IL-6 goes sky high in infections like meningococcal sepsis. And it doesn't go sky high in other things like viral disease. So this has lots of potential to be a good biomarker. I think that it is yet to be shown whether it has the ability to predict the future, as it were, to tell us a child who's early in their infection whether they're going to get sick or not, which is something we still need. I think we need to show its value against a whole range of different types of bacterial infection. We need to show its value in conditions that look like bacterial sepsis. But this is, I think, an example of how we have a lot of knowledge of different responses that the body makes to infection that we can harness. And each one of them requires careful clinical trials and careful studies to show it works. And this is a step on that direction. So it would be really exciting if you could put a bit of blood into a machine that would measure a few key genes and it'll come up with the findings telling you, is this a bacterial infection or is it a viral infection or have they got both? Or in fact, have they got an inflammatory condition, perhaps alongside a bacterial infection? Or are they actually critically ill, even though they've got a viral infection and they mustn't go home because they've got biomarkers that predict organ dysfunction? So we think that this is actually feasible. And one of the roadblocks to really rolling this out as a clinical test is actually understanding exactly which genes to measure. But we are one of a number of groups working on this, and that work is well underway. The other roadblock is having a technology which can simultaneously measure these different genes and do it in a way that is cheap, quick, and accurate. And I have now working with what I consider to be the most exciting group of people I've ever worked with in my life, which includes you, Emma, as you know, in a big consortium that spans Europe and extends beyond that as well, working on ways to discover which the best genes are to measure, and simultaneously also working with pioneers coming from completely different fields like electrical engineering, commercial companies who've got extensive arrays of new technology for this sort of stuff, to look at new ways to measure these genes in a way that could be rolled out in a clinical setting. And I can tell you that we are we are the ones with the clinical knowledge, we're the ones who've gathered the patient samples, we're the ones who've been thinking about the questions. And it's been so exciting going to talk across disciplines to other people who haven't got access to what we've got, but come to us and say, we've got machines that can do this. We need to adapt this. What a great idea. And I tell you, there's nothing more exciting than the sort of cross-fertilization you get from working across disciplines. So it's been a really great, fun experience.
This podcast was brought to you by MediSense Medical Education. Learn medicine differently through podcasts, games, videos, role plays, and more at www.medisense.org.uk.
And I think one of the really interesting things, and one of the things that we come up against a lot, is we tend to think about sepsis in straightforward patients, but actually the kind of sepsis we see a lot is in children who are already in hospital, who have complex health conditions, who have underlying immunodeficiency, and they don't necessarily respond in the way that other children do. And I think these are children who, in whom spotting sepsis is even harder, and in whom a new test would be really worthwhile.
I agree, Emma, that a lot of the antibiotic use in hospital is in patients who we are most unsure about whether they need it or not. A lot of these patients are complex with pre-existing comorbidities. For instance, they may be on cancer treatments. They may have other long-term health conditions. And in this group, it makes it particularly difficult to work out exactly whether or not they've got a bacterial infection. It also, in this group, means that we have to use our most broad-spectrum antibiotics often, because we know that if children or patients do get infections whilst in hospital, they can be with the most antibiotic-resistant types of infections. So we need to use the broadest spectrum antibiotics. So having tests that would be useful in this group is a particular challenge, but also would have particular benefits. So we are also looking at this group of patients to understand whether we can make new diagnostic tests based on gene expression to see whether we can overcome the hurdles that we have using conventional tests that are available at the moment.
So all of the research into basically being able to predict how a child is going to react to particular infections and how the trajectory of infection is going to be for each particular illness is really fascinating. In reality, how close are we to me as a junior doctor being able to take that blood test and, you know, have those answers at hand?
Oh, I want to say something that's encouraging, because I think we aren't far away, but I don't want to get ahead of myself either. So that's, it's a really fundamental question to all this. I think we are within a few years only of seeing these, the first tests in this category rolled out into common use. And I think the acid test will be how well they work in the future. If they really work as well as I think they're going to work, then we'll all be saying, oh, I want to have that too. And then they'll get rolled out quickly. So if, for instance, we are able to translate the diagnostic testing, which is we have already available for things like Kawasaki disease or TB, which are really difficult to diagnose conditions, if we can turn those into a simple test, then people will want them and they'll roll out quickly. And the roadblocks for this are translating them onto really accessible technology that could be used quickly and cheaply. But also they will have to go through trials to show that they do what we want them to do. We don't want to bring to market a test which is not as good as we say it is, because then we'll be setting ourselves back. And I think there are examples of that happening.
And I think that we must remember the application of this test would be amazing for us here in the UK, but the potential impact throughout the world, and if you think about countries with so many less resources, is even more.
As junior doctors and clinicians on the ground, how do you think we can help? How can we work with the research teams to make this more of a reality? Is there anything that we can do to help?
Sign the consent forms. Ask patients to take part.
That's absolutely right there, Emma. I think that's really important. You know, we have been working on designing, on discovering diagnostic signatures of different disease conditions in children over the last few years. And all of this work has only been possible thanks to a lot of work from big teams involved in patient care. We have the junior doctors who were taking bloods and taking research samples. We have research nurses who are meticulously recording clinical information, so we're absolutely clear about which patient samples fit with which conditions. And without input from clinical teams, we wouldn't be where we are now. And I really think that it's great if in your institution you can have a climate in which it's seen that research is part of everyone's, I would say, responsibility, but also shared endeavor in a more positive way, and that patients also, I hope, can see themselves as part of the solution to a problem, so that patients are at the heart of the research as well.
I think that's so true. When we were consenting patients and we said to them, we're taking your samples, this actually won't help you at all, but it might help you in the future. It might help your children's children. They could really understand and they could feel that they were part of this journey of innovation.
Yeah, absolutely. It's amazing how few patients don't want to take part in these studies. We benefit from their amazing generosity.
And if you have one take-home message?
For thousands of years, doctors have been trying to learn from their patients how to make accurate diagnoses. And despite all of this, and despite the revolution in diagnostic testing, we're still not very good at it. And we need a new paradigm for making accurate diagnoses in our patients.
Yeah, it's a big ask, that.
Well, it's very clear from our studies across Europe that most children admitted with an infection will leave without a firm diagnosis. Even if you're sick enough to have a blood test and be admitted, the majority of those patients will leave with uncertainty about what was actually making them sick. So the proof is in the numbers. We need better tests. Top tips. One, when it comes to sepsis, always listen to the parents. Always worry about an unexplained tachycardia. Okay, my third, my most important top tip, always enroll your children into research studies. Because without that, there'll be no progress made.
All right, that's brilliant. That was good. I enjoyed it. Yeah, Jethro, I always enjoy talking to you.
Well, I enjoy talking to you, Emma. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jethro. That's just really inspiring. I think it's so important to think about the lab and the science behind what we do every day. And I think your one real message is, as always, patients are there with you. They're part of this journey. And when they take part in research, that's when we get incredible results that can change things for the future.
The Paediatric Sepsis Podcast Series was brought to you by the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health and Medisense, with support from Health Education England.